I want to thank the rest of the team, Greg, Anik, Richard, and Dan, that keeps the magnet seminars going. But most of all, I want to thank all the speakers that have been participating to magnet so far. And so usually we have 30 minutes seminar, and then some time for discussion, and then we would like to invite you to stay after the recording stop to have an informal catch up, if you want, and which is not recorded, of course. So I would like now to welcome Yael, who will be talking of magnetic properties of the late Holocene Dead Sea sediments as a monitor of regional hydroclimate. Thank you very much, Yael.
Thank you. Okay. Do you see my screen?
Yes. Thank you.
So thank you very much for coming and listening. As Anita said, I will talk today on the magnetic properties of the late Holocene Dead Sea sediments as a monitor for regional hydroclimate. And I first want to say that I had a wonderful time to work with all these wonderful people, Ilan Levy, Ron Shah, Shang Zhao, Andrew Roberts, and Moti Stein on this project. So I will start with this beautiful picture. This is the Holocene sediments. This is the Dead Sea. The Dead Sea is a terminal hypersaline lake. And in the last 30 years, the Holocene sediment is being exposed since the lake level drops 1 meter per year. We have these micro canyons forming along the shores. And basically for us, for the geologists, it gives us fresh sediments from the Holocene that we can work and study on it. And I sampled in my PhD, three micro canyons from different locations along the western shore of the Dead Sea. So if we are looking here on this map, this is the Sea of Galilee. Here we have the Dead Sea. And this is the main source of freshwater to the Dead Sea, is the Jordan River. And my outcrops are here. This is the first one, Og, who sits here in the northern part of the Dead Sea, 5 kilometers south of it. I sampled from Ein-Feshkha Springs, one of the canyons is shown here where I sampled. And 40 kilometers south of it, I sampled from Ein-Gedi, one of the canyons in Ein-Gedi Spa. All the three outcrops represent more or less the same time periods. We took radiocarbon dating samples from the sediments. And I started sampled all the outcrops from the same unconformity that is very distinctive, and you can see it in the field easily. Wait, sorry. Okay. So in the Dead Sea sediment, in the Holocene Dead Sea sediment, we have two magnetic minerals. We have titanomagnetite and greigite. The greigite is being transported to the lake by dust or by floods. The rocks around the Dead Sea are carbonates. So the titanomagnetite comes from far away. And the other mineral, greigite, which is iron sulfur mineral, is microbially mediated. It's a production of sulfate-reducing bacteria. If we look here on the magnetic measurements, the result from the three outcrops, the green colors are the results from the Og, the northern section. The red ones are the result from Ein-Feshkha, the one that's 5 kilometers south of it, and then Ein-Gedi from the southern one, all the results are in blue. Here we have the susceptibility, ARM, IRM, and IRM divided by susceptibility along the height of the sediment. We can see that we don't get the same result, where in Og we have a relatively constant and high susceptibility. In Ein-Feshkha, we see changes in the susceptibility. We start with lower values than Og, and then we go to higher values and go back again to lower values. And in Ein-Gedi, we don't even get to the higher values of Og and Ein-Feshkha, and we have a very low values for the susceptibility, which can two orders of magnitude lower than the one in Og. So one of the questions that came out were, if these three outcrops represent the same, more or less the same time period, and they are located in the same lake, why all the three sites have different susceptibility values? And which one of the magnetic mineral, is it the greigite or the titanomagnetite, that changes the susceptibility values? And to answer that, I took samples from from distinctive areas with changes in the susceptibility from each outcrop. And I ran four measurements, and I looked in the electron microscopy. So if we're gonna start here, again, we are in Og, in the northern section with the high and relatively constant susceptibility. When I looked in the electron microscopy, the sample was full of aggregate of greigite, and you can see that the fourth diagram shows us that we have interacting greigite particles, and it was not obvious that greigite is in charge. When we moved, if we looked in the Ein-Feshkha section, in the high values as the one in Og, again, no surprises. Greigite all over the sample was full of aggregates of greigite. And you can see the fork with the interacting greigite with the high coercivity. When I looked on samples that came from intermediate value from Ein-Feshkha, I suddenly start to see a mixture in the iron sulfur minerals. I saw the PY represent pyrite, GR the greigite, and I start to see a mixture of pyrite and greigite. So we had less greigite in the sample, and you can see also here that we have lower coercivity and less greigite in our samples. When we move to the section, the outcrop of Ein-Gedi, which is 40 kilometers south of it, I barely found any iron sulfides mineral. The ones that you see here are one of the few that I found. I found pyrites. I found some aggregates of greigite, and the dominant magnetic mineral was titanomagnetite. You can see also here in the fork diagrams. So if we summarize what I just showed you, basically the more greigite that we have, the higher the susceptibility. And the changes that we see in the susceptibility reflects changes in the amount of greigite. So why we will have changes in the amount of greigite along the same lake? And to answer that, we need to understand how the greigite forms in the Dead Sea. So greigite is a iron sulfur mineral and is the precursor to pyrite. And if we look here on this very basic and simple diagram of anoxic condition on the formation of greigite, in order to get greigite, which is here, we need to have availability of sulfate and organic matter. And these little creatures, the sulfate reducing bacteria, produce sulfides, which reacts with the reactive iron that been reduced by iron reducing bacteria. And in order to get to pyrite, what we need is ore that the sulfite reducing bacteria will reduce more sulfate, and they will add sulfides into the system, or that we will lose iron from the greigite. In order to understand the changes between the outcrops in the amount of greigite and along each outcrops, we measure the limiting factors for the producing of the greigite. We measure it in the pore fluids, and we looked how much sulfite we have in the pore fluids. Did we run out of sulfate in some of the places? We checked how much reactive iron we have in the sediment. And since we are in the Dead Sea, which is a hypersaline lake, and it's a very harsh environment for microbial activity, we measure the salinity as well. The pore fluids work was done by Ilan Levy. We collected the pore fluids. Here you can see how we extracted the pore fluids from the same places that we took the palomagnetic measurements, sample. And we extracted the pore fluids from the sediment that we took. And basically the pore fluids are the trapped Dead Sea brine from the water sediment interface. So they're basically telling us what was the composition of the water in the water sediment interface. So if we look on the result of TDS, and TDS is total dissolved solid. As I said, we are in a very hypersaline lake. We can't just measure salinity, we're measuring total dissolved solids. So here we have the TDS versus the height of the sample. Samples from Ein-Feshkha are in red, sample from Og are in green, and samples in blue are from Ein-Gedi from the south. And we got an average of 334 gram per liter, which is very high salinity. Oh, wait. Okay, sorry. And it's similar to the salinity that was measured in pore fluids from the Holocene ICDP deep core. And basically it tells us that during the exposure, the formation of these micro canyons, there was no post evaporation and there is no mixing with fresh and groundwater, which makes us happy. And it's also teaches us that there are no changes in the salinity that might affect the microbial activity. When we look on the reactive iron that we measured, again, this is the height of each sample, and the red ones are from Ein-Feshkha. We have the green one from Og and the blue one from Ein-Gedi. We have excess of reactive iron. So it tells us that we have iron reduction in the sediments. So we have iron reduction all the time. If we look on the sulfate, we didn't run out of sulfate. We do have sulfate in all outcrops. You can see this is Ein-Feshkha, Og, and Ein-Gedi. Does it tells us that we have incomplete microbial sulfate reduction? So if we go back, I know I just said a big bump, but if we go back here, if we do have sulfate, they should have continued working. if we do have reactive iron, this and this will create greigite, but it doesn't, something limits the activity. And the thing that limits the activity is the organic matter. So this is the conclusion that we got, that the availability of organic matter limits the microbial activity. And again, we are in a very harsh environment, and the organic matter is very, it's not a common thing in the Dead Sea. It's not just like that, that they call it the Dead Sea. And the main, the significant organic matter source in the Dead Sea is the Donalea algae. It's a, it blooms, it's an algae that blooms in the upper surface of the Dead Sea. When you have sufficient supply of fresh water to the lakes, that basically creates a very a thin, less saltier layer on the top, and this enables the Donalea to bloom. And we see that we need a fresh water in order to have organic matter. So you ask yourself, what is the correlation? What's the correlation between the greigite content and the Jordan River? So as I said at the beginning, the Jordan River is the main freshwater source to the lake. And it's also the main source of iron to the lake. There are 4,000, before they dammed the Jordan River, 4,000 tons of iron reached the lake. And if we look on these three diagrams that represent data from Og and Feshcha and Ein-Gedi, Og is the north, and Feshcha next to it, and Ein-Gedi in the south. The dark gray dots are from our measurements of the susceptibility, and the red rectangles are the reactive iron in the pore fluids. And we can see it along the height of each section. You can see that there is, from my opinion, a beautiful correlation between the reactive iron concentration and the susceptibility. Og has more or less this, the a uniform susceptibility value and also the concentration of the iron. And whenever we see changes in the susceptibility, we have changes in the reactive iron. And the same thing in Ein-Gedi. Another thing that we see is that, again, the we have a two order of magnitude less. This is a logarithmic. So here we have closer to one in the reactive iron, and here we have 0.01 of reactive iron. So what we see that the susceptibility is basically controlled by the microbial activity. And the iron reduction is relatively high compared to the sulfate reduction. I will explain it in a minute. It means that every sulfate that been reduced, we have reactive iron to interact with it, and we are stuck with greigite. Now, you can see that the concentration of iron is higher in Og and in Feshcha, which are closer to the Jordan River. The northern, the outcrops are more greigite in the sediment because we have more fresh water input. So we have the bloom of the Donalea algae. We have more also organic matter. And the more greigite, the higher susceptibility at the outcrops closer to the Jordan River. Now I took the result from Ein-Feshkha since it's the longest outcrop that I have. I have 4.6 meters. We calculate a model, age model, using carbon 14 for it, and I compare it to changes in the Dead Sea level. So here what we have in this image diagrams is the first one, the green one, is changes in lake level in the Dead Sea of the last 3,500 years. This is the susceptibility from Ein-Feshkha, running average susceptibility of from Ein-Feshkha with the aging model that we calculated. And this is delta O18 from speleothem from the Sore cave, and delta O18 from foraminifer from the Eastern Mediterranean, which basically comparing between them two, we see the blue error show us when there is more rain. And the higher susceptibility values that we see in Feshcha correlates to periods with a higher lake level. I think we can use the susceptibility as a proxy for changes in freshwater influx to the Dead Sea. I know we are covering in here a much shorter periods of time, but I think we can extend it. And thank you for listening. And if you want to hear more about it, and if you want to hear about the secular variation that came out from the Ein-Feshkha outcrop, you are welcome to read the last GQ papers that I published in the last year. Sorry, I thought that I have 20 minutes. Anita told me at the beginning that I have 20 minutes, but I finished. Thank you.
Oh, it's great. Thank you very much, Yael. Let's give a big round of applause. Thank you very much.
Stop sharing? You want me to stop sharing?
Yeah, as you prefer, really. I would like to leave some time for people to formulate questions. So please, if you have questions, then just raise your hand or unmute yourself. And thanks again, Yael, very interesting presentation. I also look forward to read the other paper correlated to this work. So does somebody has a question? Don't be shy. Well, then you can anticipate us what the secular variation was telling us.
Okay.
I'm curious.
You're curious. I know.
I guess the core that you used for the secular variation were, oh, you were ready.
I took the Ein-Feshkha one.
Yes. So Ein-Feshkha was, remember me, the middle one. The one that you had the longest record of.
Yes.
Okay.
And so basically, if from each outcrop, I took from, you can see five from each horizon. And then, it's thousands of samples. And then this is what we got, the declination and inclination, and we calculate the age model that I didn't show you before. We collected the small, twigs. Like, yes. Very small twigs, because you don't want to get something that is big. This is a desert. It's more likely that small things will be in
yes
the area. And this is how it looks like when you put the time in it.
Yes.
And this is how it looks like. The red one is Ein-Feshkha.
Yes.
Inclination, declination. And here we have the archaeomagnetics measurements that we took from Shar and Temat 2018 and 2021. And I think we have a good correlation. I think, Anita, you would be interesting to read this paper because
yes,
we did some shift in the age there, that it will be too complicated now to go into it.
Sure.
But I think that these greigite sediments basically give us two presents. One of them is a high secular variation. And you have to understand that here you have the sedimentation rate is crazy. It's 0.4 centimeter. It's a very high sedimentation rate. So you can get a very high resolution secular variation. And for my opinion, we can learn more about lake level changes in the Dead Sea. You have to understand that it's not easy to find. If you ask yourself, what is this question mark here? It's because people for many decades are fighting to find a good geological evidence of what was the lake level. And it keeps changing with years. I think the susceptibility will not give us an accurate what was the lake level, but it can tell you when it's above this seal. And the seal is basically a physical blocker between the two. If we'll go, wait, let me, if we look here. You see, the Dead Sea basically today is below the seal and it's divided to two basins.
Yes.
And when it's above minus 402, it's one lake. It's one basin. And the places that the susceptibility was high was when it was above this minus 402. And it's when you have a really a lot of input of fresh water into the lake, which means that the whole area will start to get rain.
From the Jordan River, right?
Yeah,
that's very, very interesting. Thank you. So there are some comments in the chat. Wynne Williams said, I enjoyed the talk. Apologies, Italy. Alicia Irurzun says, congratulations, very interesting talk. Yes, thank you very much. It's very interesting. I wonder if there could be a continuation of this work in terms of, say, okay, sediment core of the Dead Sea, and how that record would compare with your very detailed high resolution results.
I didn't understand which core.
No, if there is a core that mm-hmm. you could get access to, then you could cover time.
There is. This is where all my PhD started. There was this ICDP deep drilling core in the Dead Sea, and Norbert is familiar with all of this, and I sampled from the. It's covered 450 meters in the last 220,000 years.
Wow.
But there is a problem. The Dead Sea is in a tectonic place.
Yes.
They choose the deepest part in the Dead Sea. And for my opinion, I think that at least the Holocene tells it, all the inclination in the Holocene that I sampled were 20 degrees.
Okay.
They didn't have declination. They didn't took oriented cores. And that was something that we suspected, that people said that the since it's in a tectonic basin, a lot of the material is being
tilted.
Not just tilted, but also like a turbulence of.
Okay. Okay.
And I think the inclination says it. We got the whole Holocene. I think, wait, let me see. Just a minute. I think I have it here.
The chat is flooded with compliments.
Oh, I deleted it. But I had it. It was disappointing. But
that's okay.
Part of science.
Yes, absolutely. It's the process. But perhaps even if the sediments are tilted, you could still measure, you know, rock magnetic properties and correlate that.
Exactly.
To recognize.
I agree. Them. I agree. And we did, but it's much easier. Well, you know, the benefits when you go to the outcrop and you take as much as material as you want. Is an advantage. Sure. The one thing that we were afraid of is that fresh water will get interfered. But as we saw the salinity, the TDS, we were a relief.
Yes, it didn't change much.
No.
Well, thank you very much, Yael. I think we don't have other questions. I don't see any hands raised. I guess I can share my screen again. Thanks again for presenting.
Thank you for inviting me.
So for our next seminars, we have 17th of November, Uwe Kircher from Tübingen, and then 1st of December, Mark Sier from Burgos. Then we are gonna have a break for AGU times. And we are looking for speakers for next year. We especially encourage any career scientists and anybody who wants to present, please get in touch with me and Greg. And please follow us on the YouTube channel. You can catch up with this recorded talk and the previous ones. And thanks again, Yael, for presenting. And thanks all for coming to MagNetZ. Hope to see you soon. Thank you very much.
Thank you.